Hey, what's going on everyone, and welcome to a new video. So I figured I'd film a video and hopefully I can get this one done relatively quickly. Although, you know, as you guys know, unlike my sex life, my videos usually last a long time.
Ass and titties, ass, titties, titties, ass and titties.
It's time to stop!
So this video is going to be about a computer I picked up last year, actually, almost about a year ago. It was in September of 2020, and I picked this up as a kind of just a test machine, or just like a secondary kind of laptop. Also, one that I could lend out to people if I needed to, which actually has come in handy a couple of times over the last year or so. And as you can tell by the look of it, as you can tell by that logo there, it is a Microsoft Surface laptop. Specifically, this is the Surface laptop, well, the original, from 2017. So, I just wanted to go over this thing. I've had it for a little while, and I've been using it, and I have wanted to make a video on it for a little while now, but I figured now was as best a better time as any, as, well, we're right around the corner from Windows 11. You know, this machine is actually running Windows 11. It's actually my test machine for Windows 11 currently. We're right around the corner from Windows 11, and this machine is not on the supported list. Curious as to whether or not this will be a good value to buy in, you know, 2021 or the future as a Windows 11 PC. Obviously, I mean, you could run Windows 10 on there, or it'll be supported for the next I think till 2025. However, recently Microsoft they've sort of finalized the specifications for Windows 11 a little bit more. Now, they still do require an 8th generation Intel CPU or 2nd generation AMD Ryzen or later. However, they've made a couple of changes where if you're a quote-unquote enthusiast, is what they categorize it as. I mean, I guess they're kind of right in that with using that term. You can just use the media creation tool to upgrade, well, mostly any PC, including something like this, which has a 7th generation i5. So that begs the question to me: is something like this worth it as a buy in 2021? For what you get, because it's a relatively nicely built laptop, and is this worth buying over a brand new computer with technically newer specifications but lesser build quality? That's what we're going to take a look at. So let's just have a look at the hardware overview. Let's go around the machine, just take a look at it. So mine is in the most common color you'll find these in, which is called platinum. It's more of a silver, it's a silver color. It's the raw color of the aluminium shell, but they call it platinum, as well as it uses a gray. It's a platinum, the aluminium shell, as well as it's a gray interior on the keyboard deck, which we'll discuss a little bit later. I believe these first generation ones came in 4 different colors. They came in this platinum color. I believe they came in a burgundy color. I don't remember what that was called. It might be called burgundy, actually. It's sort of a dark red. They also came in a blue color, I believe, which was called cobalt, which is actually the color I prefer out of these. As well as I think they also came in a weird sort of goldish, dark gray sort of color. It was very strange, and it only existed on the first generation. I've never seen one come up for sale in that color, and I'm guessing it wasn't very popular. I actually probably would have wanted that color or the blue if I was going to buy this again, because the silver, the platinum color here, has a little bit of an issue with the keyboard deck, and we'll discuss that a little bit later on. But yeah, the platinum ones have a discoloration problem with the keyboard deck. The other ones don't have that issue. But yeah, going over it, the design of this computer is relatively—it's the same as the current Surface Laptop 4, which is the current laptop that the Microsoft sell. In fact, the only difference externally is there is a USB-C port instead of the Mini Display port there. But as you can see, overall, it's a very thin device. You can see on the right-hand side here, we have the Surface Connect port, which is for charging the device, as well as using the proprietary Microsoft docking stations. This is a USB 3.0 based, rather than, it's not Thunderbolt, which is a common criticism of the Surface laptop that doesn't use Thunderbolt 3. You can see we have a little plastic window here for the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth antennas. But that's it. That's all on the right side. The front, we don't really have anything to take note of. Not even a little thing to take to open the screen with, which is a criticism that we'll get into later. On the back, we just have the vent for the computer, for the fans. So you can see it runs all the way across the bottom there. And the right-hand side, we also have, left-hand side, we have a USB 3.0 Type-A port, a mini display port, and a headphone jack, as well as another plastic window for the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth antennas. And that's it. That's all the I/O on this computer. It's very sparse, but that's kind of commonplace for Ultrabooks these days. But this one in particular, really the only other computer I can think of that's, got less I/O than this would be the 2015 MacBook, that 12-inch one, or the current MacBook Air, which I think only has two USB C ports. On the bottom here, you can see all we have is the serial number and the product information, as well as four little rubber feet on each corner. Other than that, there's nothing to really show. The top on the lid here has a shiny Microsoft logo. If I shine it in the right light here, there you go. You can see it's a reflective Microsoft logo. Opening the machine up, we can see a few more things. We can see we have the keyboard and the trackpad, as well as we can see the keyboard deck. So the keyboard deck here is actually made of Alcantara.
Alcantara. Am I saying that right? Alcantara? Alcantara?
I guess.
Alcantara?
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 Alhambra?
Alhambra? Is it made up like Corinthian leather, or is there really something called Alcantara?
I request nothing beyond the thickly cushioned luxury of seats available even in soft Corinthian leather.
I think there really is something. I love how it's like a stunning two-tone gray melange.
Oh, you know what? It's actually made by a company called Alcantara.
This is what Microsoft... originally, the Alcantara was used as a premium signature type cover is on the Surface Pro 4. And later, I think you can still buy them. You can get the Alcantara type covers. But when the laptop came out, they decided to make it standard on all Surface laptop models. In fact, it was the only option until the Surface Laptop 3, where they decided to also give users an option of an aluminium shell.
And the whole space frame is made from aluminium, whatever that is.
But we have a pretty nice design otherwise. It's very minimalist. We have probably one of the best keyboards on a laptop I've ever used. So it's nice and quiet. It has a decent amount of key travel. As well as it doesn't really commit any cardinal sins. It has a full-size backspace, full-size shift keys, full-size enter key. The only real sin we have is the arrow keys down here. The left and the right arrow keys are full-size keys, whereas the up and down are half-height keys. Now, it makes sense to have the up and down keys half-height, but I don't like it when laptop manufacturers do this. They put the full-size left and right arrow keys. I should just make them one all like a uniform size. Other than that, though, it's a pretty standard keyboard. Caps lock and the function key both have little LEDs built in, and in fact, the function key works just like the caps lock key. You can actually just press it once, and a little LED will stay on while you can press one of the function row keys. Just like the caps lock key, it's a toggle rather than holding it down. Now, like any Surface device, there is a way to switch that around, so I believe you can disable that. As well as you can actually toggle which function keys are the defaults, whether or not it's the F1, F2, F3, or whether or not it's the actual function, like the brightness or the volume or the keyboard brightness, whatever it is, the default when you just press the key, you can toggle that around. It's a common thing on Surface devices to do that. The trackpad, this is a glass trackpad, and honestly one of the best trackpads I've ever used on a PC. It actually gets right up there with MacBook trackpads. So the trackpad is a reasonable size. My hands are rather large, but let me get something to compare it to. Here is the size of a standard iPhone. So you can see that, you know, compared to a standard iPhone, this is an iPhone 10, but I believe the 11 and the 12 are very similar. 11 Pro and 12 are very similar. You can see that, compared to the iPhone, it's not much smaller. So you definitely have a lot of space. You have a reasonable amount of space to mouse around. Yeah, it does support multi-touch gestures, and it's big enough to do those within Windows, and especially if you're running Windows 11. Windows 11 is a lot better at the multi-touch gestures than Windows 10 is. It tends to work really well under Windows 11. It is a click pad, obviously, and it's one of the diving board mechanisms, meaning that the hinge is at the top of the pad rather than the bottom. So it sort of works like this. When you press down, it's like this. So it's easier to press at the bottom than it is at the top of the pad. So when I press it, you can see it's easy to click here, but if I'm at the top, it requires a bit more force. But it is a glass pad, that means it won't wear down, and it's very smooth and silky smooth, just like the screen. So moving up to the screen here, you can see this is a 13.5-inch screen. I don't remember what the resolution is off the top of my head, but I will put it on the video. It is a what Microsoft call a PixelSense display, and it is fully touch-enabled as well, which is excellent. It's a really good screen. It's a 3:2 aspect ratio. So compared to other laptops of a similar size in the 13-inch range, or any laptop size really, 3:2 offers a better aspect ratio for using documents and such. Compared to a normal 16:9 laptop screen like this HP EliteBook, you can see that it is a lot taller. As well as there is a lot, if I just move this across, you can see compared to the HP EliteBook I'm comparing this to, which is a 16:9 screen, you can see the Surface is a lot taller, but also offers, it offers more vertical space, but it doesn't compromise horizontal space either, because watching content on it isn't the worst thing in the world. So at the top of the screen here, we have the Windows Hello compatible webcam. So it is, it is a Windows Hello compatible camera. So the webcam itself is, I believe it is a 720p camera. However, it actually doesn't do too badly when it comes to video calls and stuff like that. But next to it, we have infrared sensors and depth sensors for the Windows Hello technology. This is an early Windows Hello machine, like most Microsoft Surface devices since the Surface Pro 4. And so it can do Windows Hello facial recognition as your method of authentication. So a couple of things I don't like about this laptop. Now, there's one thing, as you notice, there's a lot of fingerprints around the top of the screen there, around where the camera is. And that's something that you really can't help but do when you open the laptop. So I'll show you. I'll just shut the lid. Okay, so now that the lid's shut, you can see that There's no little opening here to open the screen. So by default, most people will open it by grabbing the top here. And guess what happens? Your thumb is touching the camera when you do that. And I just realized you couldn't see what I was actually doing. But I'll show you again. As I go to open this laptop up, I'm just grabbing it from here. As you can see, my thumb is touching the camera. Now, or maybe I've got big hands, or maybe I'm doing something wrong. I don't know. But it's always, my thumb is always ends up touching the top of the screen or the camera there. And it always ends up really annoying me seeing just a greasy fingerprint, you know, from my, you know, woggy hands here. You know, it's just, it's not great. That's a minor detail. I mean, you can always clean the screen off, and I always end up doing that. But still, it's a kind of a design flaw, and they haven't redesigned this laptop since this one in 2017. The Surface Laptop 4 is identical to this, and they haven't put a little cutout for your thumb to grab the screen there. Because that would prevent that problem. If they put a little cutout there so that your thumb didn't actually touch the glass, then yeah, that would be ideal. The next issue I have with this computer revolves around the palm rest here. Now, I actually don't mind the Alcantara palm rest. It feels nice, even in this kind of, older, kind of shittier laptop. This one's a little bit worn. But generally, it actually feels really nice when you have your palms on here and you're typing away on the keys. The keys are plastic. The trackpad's glass, though, but as you're using the computer, the palm rest does feel nice. It's sort of, like on a really cold day, it kind of does, it doesn't get cold. So, if you're, working on a really cold morning, then yeah, you're not going to freeze your hands off by putting your palms on the laptop, which is, not really a big deal. But, like, it's a nicety that you just, you only really notice it if you use one of these. The problem with this, though, and there are a couple of problems. As you can see, the bottom corner here, if I bring it up to the camera, you can see the bottom corner on mine is actually peeling up. So, it doesn't look like it's aging the best, at least on my example here. Now, I'm not sure if this happens to other models of the Surface laptop, but my one has been peeling up from the corner and it's getting worse. In fact, I've just had a little bit dangling off there earlier that I actually just cut off with a pair of scissors just to stop it from just like catching on my palms every time. But the other problem, as you can see, is it's kind of brown. Do you notice that? And this has been cleaned before. It's a problem with the platinum colored Surface laptops, and I believe that the later ones have changed the color slightly so it doesn't affect it, but these first generation ones, I'm not sure about the second gens, but I know the Surface Laptop 3 and later has a more darker gray with the platinum casing, but the earlier ones like this discolor and they go brown, especially where your palms are going to be. Now, this has been cleaned several times and it just keeps reappearing. So yeah, that's a problem with these. If you're looking for a Surface Laptop 1, then definitely look for one that's a different color if you can. Most of them are going to be the platinum color, as I believe that was the standard configuration from Microsoft for one of the base models. This is not a base model, this one, although I think this is the upper trim, the upper spec model. But yeah, most of them are going to be in this silver platinum color, but if you can find one that's different, I would definitely go for that, because it's not going to discolor and go disgusting brown like this. So even if you clean it, it will still go brown. It doesn't really help. Other than that, though, these are actually fairly well-built machines. But there is another point of controversy with these, and that is they are not upgradable. Whatever specs they have in them from when you buy it is what you get. Now, they've made a change with these with the Surface Laptop 3 and later, where you can actually take off the top cover and you can take out the SSD. But these older ones, the Surface Laptop 1 and I believe the Surface Laptop 2, are atrocious in terms of repairing it. In fact, you can't even take off this top cover without basically destroying it. If you need to get inside here for whatever reason to replace the battery, or to, I'm not sure if the SSDs are removable, I assume they would be. Yeah, you better prepare to buy a new top case, because you're basically going to destroy this one by removing it. It's so horrible. Just look up the Surface Laptop on iFixit, the first generation. It's horrible what they had to do to it to even get it open, so... Yeah, if you care about repairability of your computer, I don't recommend this laptop at all. I recommend if you're going to get a Surface laptop, get the 3 at least, if you care about repairability of your computer. Okay, so that's really it for the exterior. Let's actually turn this on. So power button is in the keyboard there, and let me just adjust my camera there. And we can boot it up. So like I said, we're currently running the Windows 11 Insider Preview. Now, I was actually going to do a video on Windows 11, and it was going to involve this computer, actually, but I decided not to, as Windows 11... As Windows 11 is evolving at a more, is evolving at a quicker pace than I can actually put the video out. As you can see, Windows Hello just logged me in. So, because I am staring in front of it at the camera, and you don't have to be directly in front of it either, because I'm not sitting directly in front of the computer at the moment. There's my tripod with my cameras in the way. So, it actually accepts it at a fairly wide angle. So you can, you can actually be sitting sort of offset from the computer, and it will recognize you. Okay, let's go ahead and take a look at everything. So I'm going to need to, I do have the magnifier enabled. So let's go ahead and look at the system properties here. So because we're in Windows 11, let's just go to settings and... So the current build I believe we're running is the 0.168 update. Which is current as of late August of 2021, which is when this video is being made. But if we just go to system, and I don't remember where everything is in this system properties, in this settings app, I've got the Windows 10 memorized. I need to memorize the Windows 11 one, because that's what we're going to be using soon. So we can see for CPU, we have an Intel Core i5 7200U, which is a 2.7 gigahertz, 2.5 gigahertz CPU, although it does boost. I'm not sure what it boosts up to. It might boost up to, I think, 3 gigahertz, maybe? I'm not sure. We have 8 gigabytes of RAM, and we also have, this one has a 256 gigabyte SSD. So if I just go into File Explorer and we just go to the drive. I hate these right-click menus. This thing really at the bottom is throwing me off. Basically breaking muscle memory. But as you can see, yeah, we have a 256 gigabyte SSD. That is, says Windows 10 because that's what it upgraded from. Yeah, not too bad. For graphics, we have the Intel HD 630, I think? Let's find out. What is the graphics on this? It's Intel HD. HD 620, sorry. Yeah, so Intel HD 620 graphics on one of these. So it's bog standard Ultrabook for 2017. So how does this hold up today? I mean, so in terms of CPU performance, it's not going to be great because we are running only a dual core processor, and I have noticed that at least under Windows 10 anyway, I really haven't played too much with it under Windows 11, but under Windows 10, it did start to kind of bog down and get a little slow. Now, I'm not sure if that was the CPU or if that's the poor performance of the disk speed. In fact, we might find it out a little bit later, but in terms of the CPU performance, it does bog down a little bit sometimes, so that could be due to the weak processor or a weak SSD. Like I said earlier, these machines, you really can't upgrade them. What specs you get is what you're stuck with. So there are versions of this computer with 4 gigabytes of RAM. I do not recommend those at all. If you find one with 4 gigs of RAM, don't buy it. Buy one with a minimum of 8. I think they could go up to 16, I'm not sure. But yeah, in terms of RAM, get one with a minimum of 8 gigs of RAM. SSD, I'd say get the minimum of 256. Don't go for... there are versions with 128. I don't really recommend 128 gigs. In 2021, I recommend at least 256, maybe more. In terms of the processor, though, you have a choice of the i5-7200U, and I believe it's an i7 variant as well. Honestly, it really doesn't matter which one you get. They're both a dual-core processor, so they're not going to be much... the i7's not going to be much quicker than this. So I recommend... I basically recommend this spec or higher. If you can find one that's higher spec than this, then you'll be good. Graphics will always be the Intel HD 620, which is built onto the processor. So yeah, basically just minimum of 8 gigs of RAM, minimum of 256 gig of storage, CPU, doesn't matter. I believe there might be an i3 version as well. There might be a lower end version of this. I'm not too sure. I may be confusing that with the Surface Pro. But yeah, if you can get one that's basically this spec or minimum, this spec or higher, sorry, then you'll be good. So let's go ahead and run some benchmarks and see how this computer performs and whether or not we'll recommend it for purchase. Okay, so I've decided to, before we do the benchmarks, to go ahead and plug the computer in. So here is the charger. As you can see, this is the Surface Connect connector, and it just plugs in magnetically on the side. So all we have to do is just, you know, make sure that it is in the frame of the camera, of course. But we'll just make sure we just line it up, and there we go. It's magnetic, so just like the old MacBook chargers. So it's pretty cool. I love that this still exists. A lot of people complain. You see reviews of the Surface devices all the time, and a lot of people complain saying, oh, why doesn't it charge over USB-C? Microsoft should get rid of Surface Connect and make it all USB-C. And that's fine. I like USB-C charging. In fact, I've got two laptops that use it, and I can use the one charger for both, and it's great. In fact, one of the laptops with USB-C, my MacBook Pro, that one has it on both sides, so you can charge from either side. USB-C is great. But, you know, what happens that time that, you know, you have your laptop on the desk and you have no choice but to run the charger across the floor to the power point in the wall and you can't conceal the power cord and whoops, you have someone who's not paying attention and they, oh no, they trip over your power cord. Yoink. Just come straight out. And your laptop doesn't go crashing to the floor. That was a smart idea. Apple came up with it. I think they took the idea from Asian rice cookers, actually, which had the similar technology. Because, you know, on your rice cooker, you know, you don't want, you know, someone tripping over a cord and causing a fire. So I think that's where they got the magnetic technology for it. And I think they patented it for the MagSafe on the old MacBooks. But Microsoft, you know, have always done it since the very first Surface, although it's been better since the Surface Connect, since Surface Pro 3. But yeah, it's a great idea having these magnetic power cords, and I get why USB-C is the standard. We're trying to make the one connector for everything, but it still has that inherent problem of if you trip over the power cord, it's going to bring the laptop down to the table, down to the floor. That's why I love these kinds of connectors, and I wish that they should stay around. I mean, have this as well as USB-C. Have this as your main charger and have a USB-C port on here to, you know, have both in case someone wants to use a USB-C charger. Okay, so we have three benchmarks we're going to run here. Actually, four we're going to run. We're going to run Passmark Performance Test, Unigen Heaven, Cinebench, and we also have Crystal Disk Mark installed on here as well, which we're going to reuse to test the disk performance to see how it compares. So the first one we're going to run is Passmark Performance Test, and we just need to continue as a free trial, and because we have a 30-day evaluation. And, oh, system seemed to lock it up there. There we go. And so we're going to run the normal, the benchmarks. So we can choose, but this is going to run between a CPU, a 2D graphics, 3D graphics, memory, and disk. So we're going to run all of them. So, and Passmark, I believe, runs all of them. So let's go ahead and do that now. Okay, so we've run the performance test benchmark, and so the current rating we get for this computer is 1,651.1, which is the 19th percentile. So, as this is a complete result with all tests concluded, so we didn't skip anything, because sometimes, depending on the hardware, it will skip tests if it's not compatible. So CPU mark, we got 3,446.0, which is in the 18th percentile. 2D graphics was 225.7, which is in the 22nd percentile. 3D graphics, we got 982.1, which is the 23rd percentile. Memory, we got 1,749.4, which is the 20th percentile. And the disk mark, we got 3,440.3, which is in the 36th percentile. So, obviously, performance is not going to be great. This computer is, it's a few years old, and it wasn't, the most high-end when it was new. It wasn't a gaming computer. It was expensive and premium when it was new, but, it's not too bad. And besides, these kinds of benchmarks don't really represent real-world performance. But that's what we get for Performance Test 10. So let's go ahead and move on to Cinebench. Okay, so now we're running Cinebench R23. So we're going to do single and multi-core performance. So looking at the CPUs here, for the fastest for single-core CPUs is the Intel i7, the 1165G7. And the fastest for multi-core is still the old Threadripper 2990WX, which is a monster of a CPU. And close fastest for Intel is the Xeon W3265M. So we're not going to be anywhere near those. We're going to be down probably near the bottom because we're running a dual-core processor. So, but for single-core, we shouldn't do too badly, actually. We'll probably be around, probably under the 7700K. We'll be higher than some of them. Like, we'll probably be faster than the 1700X, to be honest, because it's a cable like as fast as single thread. But let's see how we do. So let's go ahead and start the single core test. Okay, so we've run the single threaded benchmark, and as you can see, we didn't do so well. So we're just above a Xeon X5650, which is a CPU from 2009, LJ 1366, and we're below a Xeon E5 2697V2, which is an Ivy Bridge part. I believe actually my workplace uses these in their servers. So, so the i5-7200U, not the fastest. So that's for single-threaded performance. I thought it would be faster than that because it is Kaby Lake, but I guess because it's low power, then, yeah, that makes sense. So let's go ahead. So we scored 560 points for the single-threaded performance. So let's go ahead and run the multi-core test. Okay, so in terms of multi-core performance, we are not doing too great. So we can see the slowest of the bunch, which I will just stop that for now. Slowest of the bunch there, and so it is. Below the slowest one below that is the Core i7-1165G7, and we're below that by a significant margin. So that's performance in Cinebench. So let's go ahead and run the next benchmark. Okay, so the next benchmark we're going to run is the Unigine Heaven benchmark. So we've chosen the Extreme preset, which is really the only one that matters, which is going to annihilate this computer, so I might actually run the basic one as well. But let's go ahead and run this. It is integrated graphics, so it is going to get annihilated. So the Extreme preset is DX11 Ultra with everything. We don't have stereoscopic 3D or multi-monitor, they're turned off. Anti-aliasing is by 8. And we're running at 1600x900. So let's go ahead and this app doesn't really scale well with a high DPI. So let's go ahead and run the benchmark. Okay, so that benchmark has run, and we can see how poor performance is. So 6.3 FPS average, and we only got a score of 158. So minimum FPS was 3.7, and a maximum was 13.2. So, yeah, not great. but then again, it is only Intel HD 630 graphics. what I want to do is I'm going to close that for now, and we're going to run the more basic benchmark. So let's go and use the basic profile. So the basic one's DX9, medium quality texture, medium quality, tessellation is disabled, stereoscopic with 3D disabled, multi-mode disabled, anti-aliasing is only by 2, and we're running at 1280 by 720 this time. So let's go ahead and start the more basic benchmark. Okay, so the basic benchmark is just run, and let's see what we have. So we have an average FPS of 21.7 and a score of 548. So minimum FPS was 7 frames a second, and maximum was actually 41, so not too bad. Again, I mean, this benchmark is, I mean, it's DX9, so, like, you know, it's integrated graphics. I mean, so what are you going to expect, right? So, honestly, not the best. Honestly, this thing can run YouTube videos, and that's probably, I mean, maybe you could do stuff with a quick sync video, but, like, that would be really it. And you only have a dual-core processor. It is hyper-threaded, but it is only dual-core, so you really don't want to be doing any kind of video editing or anything on this machine. Really, it's just meant to be for, you know, kind of basic office tasks, really. But yeah, those are the three benchmarks. I said I was also going to run a Crystal Disk Mark as well, so let's go ahead and run that one while we're here. And this will test the performance of the SSD. Okay, so let's go ahead and run the benchmark. So, there we go. And then this will do the benchmark. It'll run it 4 times for read and write speed. Okay, so we've just run the disk benchmark. And we can see that for read speeds, the maximum we got was 646.03 megabits per second. Megabytes per second, sorry. And for write speed, we got 210.5 megabytes per second. So there we are. That's that's the disk speed. So there we go. So those are the benchmarks that I wanted to run. But overall, what do I think of the Surface laptop here? Well, overall, I think it's a good value. At least for what, it depends on what you want to use it for. So I got mine in September of 2020 for about, it was about 500 I got for mine, although I believe values have decreased down to about 400-450 last time I checked. Okay, so just wanted to, while I'm editing here, I just wanted to double check what the prices actually were on eBay for the Surface laptop. And so I've just done a general search for Microsoft Surface laptop, and I've put some filters in. I just filtered down the model and the CPUs just down to the 7th generation, just so we didn't get a mix of like Surface Laptop 2s or whatever in there. And prices are a bit higher than what I expected. So this is what's currently for sale. So it's a 700 for one that's identical to mine. You can see it's an i5, it's a 7200U. With 8 gigs of RAM, a 256 gig SSD, and here's a an example of what I mean by the browning of the keyboard. If I go into here, you can see it's really discolored. So that's discolored even worse than my one. So yeah, but as you can see, 220 for this one, but it is 4 gigs of RAM and 128 gigs, so I'd avoid that like the plague. Yeah, 700, yeah, they're more expensive than I thought. Now if we go to this is Australian dollar redos. Now if we go to international, they are a bit cheaper. But yeah, there is it's a Surface Pro 3. Yeah, you can see, oh yeah, that one's really bad in terms of the keyboard. Yeah, you can see, don't get the platinum color if you can find it, but just searching, this is all you see. You only see the platinum ones. Now if I change my filters here to show only sold listings, sold items, go apply. And, oh, it wants me to capture. Okay, so if we look at sold listings here, we can see, oh, there's a blue one. You can see 399, 430, 310. And these are all recent, late July, actually. So actually a little bit old, but it has 399, 430, has 110, you know, they are a little bit cheaper than what's currently on the market. So I'd say at this time in September when this video is released, I wouldn't buy them, but check prices on eBay, because the market right now is currently a bit weird. But yeah, it wasn't a bad deal when I got mine. I got mine for $500. But yeah, I wouldn't recommend really spending any more than that. Maybe $550. It depends. That's for my spec. If you find like say an i7 with like 512 or a terabyte of storage, then yeah, maybe it might be worth, you know, $600-$700, maybe more. I don't know. It really depends on what you want to do with it. And what it's worth, what it is worth to you. If you really want one, then I guess you're gonna spend what you get. You're just gonna spend what you can. Yeah, I wouldn't really spend more than $500 on a first generation one, preferably less, to be honest. So they're a fairly solid laptop. If you're looking for something just to run Microsoft Office, a web browser, maybe a couple of casual games. Something that wouldn't require much graphics power, I think it will be a good idea. They're solid, they're a well-built machine, they're fairly lightweight, and especially if you're going to be doing stuff like, productivity work, that 3x2 display is going to be a godsend compared to a 16x9 screen on most laptops. So, the Windows Hello camera, just like that, is really awesome, but the downsides is that especially on this platinum color, the keyboard will discolor, the keyboard palm rest will discolor, as well as repairability is not great, as well as I/O isn't the greatest either. But I do think they're a decent value in 2021 for someone who's looking for just a productivity machine. So something that can do web browsing, Microsoft Office work, for a college student. Would do pretty well, I reckon. This would be a good value. So that's my video on the Microsoft Surface laptop. So thank you very much for watching, and I will see you guys in my next video. Take care.